Hi, I'm glad you all came again today. This is the third session of our class on Hubert Harrison, Theodore W. Allen, and the Centrality of the Struggle Against White Supremacy. In week one, we did an overview of Harrison, Allen, and their work and some of the important insights from them on the centrality of the struggle against white supremacy. Last week, we began Harrison's life with his Croatian roots, his roots in St. Croix, his first decade in New York, functioning in black intellectual working class circles, his break from religion, his turn to science to address social problems. And we came right up to when he was just entering the Socialist Party. So I'm just going to review one or two slides that we did last week, and then we're going to go through his Socialist Party years. We're going to talk about how he breaks from the Socialist Party, essentially because of white supremacy, and offer some important insights there. How he founds the new Negro movement, the militant new Negro movement, and then how, as he's functioning as a new Negro leader, he and William Monroe Trotter convene the Liberty Congress in 1918, which is a major black protest effort in World War I. So here goes. When Hubert Harrison joins the Socialist Party in the period around, we've seen various dates and don't have, you know, quite the identifying document, but it's in the period from 1909 to 1911. The Socialist Party identifies itself as the party of the working class, and part of Harrison's reasoning was, well, if this is the party of the working class, black people are working people, this should be a party for us, right? In 1908, the party had 40,000 members and got 3% of the vote in the election. This was a period of growth for the Socialist Party, and in 1912, they were able to get 6% of the vote, doubling their vote, which is significant for a left party in this country, right? The 1908 platform was anti-monopolies and trust, pro-nationalization of industries. Harrison would write on, he was a postal worker, he would write on the postal service as a good example of a nationalized industry that could function, you know, if it wasn't under attack constantly. And he talked about the same type of attacks back then that we're seeing today in more intense fashion. Socialist Party advocated the 8-hour workday, graduated income tax, progressive taxation, women's suffrage. They were the only one of the major parties, other than the women's movement, that advocated women's suffrage, and public works program. A lot of things we could use today, right? African Americans, when Harrison joins the Socialist Party, only 1% of the party is African American, Afro-Caribbean, had few black members, right? It had shortcomings as a functioning political party. Racism was well entrenched in the Socialist Party, and there were broad differences in the party theoretically amongst its leaders, and they ranged from outright racist advocacy of white supremacy, and I'll show you some examples, to the position that the Negro question was a class problem and nothing more, to the position that the Socialist Party should conduct a consistent and persistent struggle against racism. So there's a wide range of views in the Socialist Party. Amongst the more extreme white supremacist positions in the party is Victor L. Berger, from Wisconsin, gets elected to Congress, right? Party's first elected congressman had argued as far back as 1902 that Negroes and mulattoes constitute a lower race. Ernest Unterman, who's a leading theoretician, I am determined that my, at the convention, that my white race shall be supreme in this country and the world. And Julius Wayland, who's editor of the Appeal to Reason, which had a circulation of 500,000, was a strict segregationist who believed that black people like whites preferred to live in communities of their own. Within the party, overall, and I find this interesting because I come of age in the 60s and 70s, and there are all these dividing lines in the left, if you will. In the socialist movement, in this period, major differences, the core major difference was how are they going to get to socialism. Is it going to come by evolutionary or revolutionary means, right? And what they meant by that, broadly speaking, is the following. Evolution through gradual political gains or the more revolutionary militant strikes and revolution. In 1908, the party platform actually opposed reform work, at least in their platform, right? They were taking that militant stand. And it was very critical of reform movements. There was, however, strong internal opposition to the party position from the evolutionary socialists, who saw aspects of socialism and nationalization, such as the post office, and who saw socialism coming piecemeal by reform and legislation. Second pivotal issue in the Socialist Party at this time was the trade union question. It's the party of the working class, so the question was, how are they going to relate to the unions? All the party leaders supported industrial multi-craft unions, workers coming together in their workplace and their industry. The debate was over whether the party should work within the generally conservative trade union movement. That's the construction trades in particular. And that movement, the trade union movement, was headed in particular by the 1.7 million member American Federation of Labor. And in the AFL, they did not challenge all white unions or the existence of segregated federal Negro unions. They let each union run its own affairs, right? One second. In 1901, the Socialist Party had taken the position not to interfere in internal trade union questions, and it was reaffirmed. So for those unions that had the whites-only clauses and white supremacist policies, the Socialist Party was not challenging their work. Harrison, and this is part of his, I think, his importance as a radical, he saw the reality, he knew what he was dealing with, and he tried to reach both wings, both groups. These are factions, right? Both factions in the party with the arguments on why it was important to organize black workers, you know, into the Socialist Party and how it was consistent with their aims. So, and he, in so doing, he proposed a new crucial litmus test for the Socialist Party. He's really a pioneer in doing this. And that test was to champion the cause of the Negro, to wage this fight against white supremacy, right? And he thought this was the key to revolutionary change and strategy. So this is, again, where Harrison's a real pioneer in the left and socialist movement in this country, right? And he addressed the two large factions using the logic of their position. To the political socialists, he agreed that the power of the voting proletariat could be expressed through ballot with good political organizations. Workers could secure control of the powers of government, that they could secure legislation in the interest of the working class. And he stressed that in work for the abolition of capitalism by legislation, the Negro could certainly help. And of course, he was dealing now with the issue of so many black people being disfranchised, not having the vote and stuff like this. So he was stressing how important work in this area would be. To the revolutionary socialists, people like the IWW, the Industrial Workers of the World, who were engaged in point-of-production economic organizing, even in the South, Harrison explained that even the voteless proletarian can help towards the abolition of the capitalist system. These workers, though absent the ballot, possess labor power, which they can be taught to withhold. They can organize themselves at the point of production. They can work to shorten the hours in the workday, to raise wages, to enforce laws for the protection of labor. He gives the example of the Western Federation of Miners, which was an IWW union, who had been successful in winning the eight-hour workday without the aid of the legislatures or the courts. So in such work, he again argued that African Americans could work. And this was in contrast, when Harrison's taking these positions, it is in marked contrast to positions taken by Booker T. Washington, who's the preeminent black leader in that period. Harrison was, you know, really trying to push the way forward for work amongst black workers by the socialists.
Was he still working at the
post office? Yes, he's still working. Well, in 1907, he gets fired, I think, late 1910, 1911. So it's around this period, because we don't have the exact date when some of these arguments he makes a little later when he's writing his major series in the party. But this was influencing his work while he's in the post office, because he writes some major pieces on postal work. In 1911, I believe. Okay, so now two other things, and this is how Harrison was able to learn from what was going on. Besides learning from that struggle, the factional struggle, there were two other groups that he paid particular attention to in the Socialist Party. One was foreigners, right? Party work among foreigners was in the midst of a significant growth. In 1904, a Finnish federation was set up. Over the next 11 years, there would be many others, the Lettish, the South Slav, Italian, Scandinavian, Bohemian, German, Polish, Jewish, Lithuanian, and Russian. So they would hold meetings in their own language, right? These federations. They were affiliated with national state office. They developed separate organizations. By 1917, 33,000 out of 80,000 people in the Socialist Party were in these federations. So Harrison sees that, right? Because there's only 1% black in the party, right? So maybe there's something to learn from that. Women. Similar gains were also made in party work by women. The majority of socialist leaders was similar to their approach to the question of Negro equality for many. You know, the Negro question was part of the general labor problem. That was a dominant position of the male leadership in the Socialist Party.
Was that basically the United States, or was that...
We're talking about the United States right now.
The Socialist Party.
Yeah, no, this is Socialist Party of America. Formally, however, as with the Negro question, there was not a single coherent ideology. They did pay particular attention because they were pushing for women's right to vote, so they struggled for that. The Socialists were the only major party to allow women members and to support the goal of equal suffrage for women. This is in the period before women have the right to vote, right? But in the positive sense, the Socialist Party's progress on women's issues was strongly influenced by an independent women's movement, right? In 1901, Socialist Party women formed the Women's National Socialist League to teach socialist principles to women and to agitate and demand equal rights and political rights for women. Independent efforts, including women working outside of the party on political and broader social issues, helped to increase female party membership from 3 to 5% from 1904 to 1908. At the 1904 party convention, an all-females women's national committee was established to focus on women's socialist activities. And after 1908 convention, each party local was invited to organize women's branches. So a branch is a subdivision of the local. This is important for what's going to happen, right? And as these women's groups grew, some were autonomous and some functioned under the leadership of the local party. So it wasn't all clear. They were, you know, trying to work things out. But there was much initiative from women, and they were making some progress. By 1910, there were 150 such women's clubs, right? And the work of these clubs was heightened by the struggle of women in the garment industry, particularly in places like New York, right here, right, where we had major struggles. And they were major factors in the increase of women in the Socialist Party. By 1913, they were up to 15% of the party, right? Again, Harrison's coming 1% black, right? But now it's up to 15% women, and we see how significant the foreign membership is. So he learns from both those examples, right? Yeah.
The women part, did it consist of any African American or Negro women?
Very few, very few. And if you ask me to name some in the early period, I'm not sure that I have names. I mean, later on, within a few years, we have some who are in and around Harrison. But it's 1% and it's mostly male. The party is still, you see, in that early period, mostly male. But, okay, Harrison, by 1911, is really advocating and expressing hope in socialism, the overturning of the present system to elevate a new class into a power, a class to which the Negro belongs. Again, the party of the working class, he says, well, that should be the party for us. And he believed that was the promise of socialism. So he goes into socialism wholehearted, right? It's a wholehearted move. As a socialist theoretician over the next few years, Hubert Harrison makes major contributions. He analyzes racial oppression as socio-historical, not biological. He advocates a new litmus test for socialists, championing the cause of African Americans as a revolutionary doctrine, but also as a key to revolutionary strategy. He emphasizes the duty of all to oppose race prejudice, and he advocates and initiates a colored socialist club, drawing from the foreigners and from the women, right? When Harrison advocates a colored socialist club, There are two other leading black activists in New York. One is the Reverend George Frazier Miller, who's from Brooklyn. The other is Du Bois. Du Bois is a big name. He's active in the party, but not a full-time activist or anything. And they both have hesitations over the notion of a colored socialist club. One is worried about the effect it might have on the white comrades, you know, segregating, and others, the effect on the black comrades. That's what's expressed. So they don't really get behind this effort. And I discuss this in the biography, Hubert Harrison, The Voice of Harlem Radicalism. I discuss this at some length, right? But what's interesting about that, and first, before I go further, this whole notion of a colored socialist club, what it's going to do, it's going to be, it's not all black, right? But it's going to try and reach out to attract black people into the Socialist Party through special appeals and special efforts. Now, this is just slightly parenthetical, but within the last 4 or 5 years, in current organizations, one of the leading organizations in this country, there was an effort by black, Latin, and Asian comrades, if you will, who wrote to the local office and then to the national office saying basically, you know, we've got some very talented comrades of color, whatever the phrase they use, right? And we'd like to do some work in our communities to try and bring people in. And it was rebuffed. It was rebuffed. And there's a whole debate, and I can point people to that later if they want to read about it. So some of these issues are still very current, right? Going on. Now, this need for a special approach, I won't belabor this, but if you want to get into it, you can look in the biography. But Harrison, more than Du Bois or Frazier Miller, was leading in the argument for a special approach to African Americans. In time, he would change his position and argue that the Socialist Party, as U.S. society, white supremacy, was so prevalent that a separate black organization was needed. That's where he's going to move later on, right? But Harrison would always argue for black initiative in such autonomous efforts, not, you know, if black people were being segregated against, right? So, for instance, during World War I, when there's the question of segregated officers' training camps, the military one, Harrison opposes that, right? Because that's not black initiative. That's being imposed. And at that time, the NAACP, and again, this is discussed in the book, supports it. And this is when Du Bois issues a statement about we face a condition, not a theory. People might, you know, want to look at some of these things theoretically. And going on with this, in 1912, Harrison, while functioning in the Socialist Party, had undertaken a pioneering effort striving for a degree of black autonomy. He preceded a similar effort by Du Bois. Though Du Bois criticized Harrison's efforts in 1911, 1912, by 1914, as editor of the Crisis magazine, the NAAP's magazine, he would make a somewhat similar argument for more autonomy in editing that publication of that organization. And beginning around 1934 and continuing to 1940, when he wrote his autobiography, Dusk of Dawn, Du Bois would argue for full black organizational autonomy, a position that Harrison reached by 1916. So again, you know, you see some of these ideas and how people are trying to deal with the reality that they're confronting, right?
What's the age range and difference between Du Bois and...
Du Bois is, let's see, I think.
Du Bois,
15 years older, I believe, Du Bois.
He's 15 years older than...
Yeah, and he lives to 93. He lives 50 years more also. All right. So Hubert Harrison writes the first major theoretical series, actually there are two series, on the Negro and socialism by a black comrade, if you will. He begins a major five-part theoretical series in the New York Call, which is the paper of the Socialist Party, local New York Socialist Party, right? And in that, he argues the Negro has a problem, history and past social relationships, and the Negro problem was a question of social adjustment, of social control, of relationships. Social control is a thing, a notion we will come up and address much more in Allen's work. He argued against a biological analysis of the race problem, and he maintained that race relationships have a history, much as a class struggle and a system of production have theirs. So it's a historical approach, it's a sociological, you know, a social approach, not a biological approach. It is in this period that he argues what we discussed in that first session, and he writes some and offers profound insights in one of his articles on the Negro and Socialism series, when he writes that politically, the Negro is the touchstone of the modern democratic idea. The presence of the Negro puts our democracy to the test and reveals the falsity of it. And again, for those who might have missed that first session when we discussed this, the touchstone is the black stone. You rub it against the metal to see if it's really gold. It's an important guide to action. Every issue we look at, let's put it to the test. How are black people faring? What are we going to do about it? And in that same passage, Du Bois writes, true democracy and equality implies a revolution startling to even think of. Again, what we talked about in that first session, how he foreshadows the 1960s, when the civil rights, black liberation struggle is a catalyst for every other movement, progressive movement in this country, the women's movement, labor movement, anti-war movement, student movement, and why the principal reasons I suggest are because the struggle is just, number one, and two, because it hits so directly at how the ruling class maintains social control, right?
Quick question, you said Du Bois, but that was like all said by Hubert Harrison.
Right? This is Hubert Harrison saying this, all this touchstone and stuff like that. Yeah. Okay. Now, part of the appeal to me of Harrison when I first came across him 30 some odd years ago, right, was his understanding, because I started out, before I got to Harrison, I was familiar with Allen, but I was addressing the question of why no socialism in this U.S. and how white supremacy was such a retardant, right? And I was reviewing all the different organizations and parties from the turn of the century on. I mean, you know, I have manuscripts and Xerox copies, I mean, boxes and boxes. I was familiar with all the literature, and when I come across Harrison on the two key issues, I think, in terms of getting white workers to struggle against white supremacy, he is clear, and we see these again in Allen later on, many years later. Although, when Allen's writing, he was not aware of Harrison's writings, but this is, you know, I being familiar with both, I see, you know, the similarity in what they're arguing. So Harrison argues against the idea that racism is innate. He thinks that's the core of so many racist arguments, because if racism is innate, why fight it? You can't change it, you can't do anything about it. And the second idea is that white workers benefit from race prejudice, and I'm going to get into this a little more. And this is crucial, because if you go, as I've mentioned before, if you go on Wikipedia and you look up white privilege, the first thing they're going to say is all white people benefit from privilege. And Harrison and Allen are arguing something very different. Allen says it's a poison bait. This is not in your interest. This divides the class. You know, this drags things down. It keeps us disunited, right? And Harrison is making the same argument. So here we go. Harrison challenges racism as innate. And he said, at their core, arguments defending race prejudice come down to that. That's one of the arguments he made. He also argued that protected white workers, privileged white workers, don't gain from racism. As for the protected or privileged group, their situation was also described as ruinous by Harrison. He explained that as the protected group demanded for itself a larger share of its products, its demands were met with the cold fact that other wage slaves are doing as hard work or harder and doing it for less. If the protected group strike, the strikes can be broken by the use of these other workers, right? Who gained? And this is where Harrison is again so very insightful. And again, we see this echoed later in Allen. To Harrison, it was in the interest of the capitalist of America to preserve the inferior economic status of the colored race. So that's the driving force, is what he's arguing, because they can always use it as a club for other workers by pitting white against black. The capitalists keep the wage level as low as possible and foster disunity in the class. Thus, race prejudice was a very useful tool to divide the workers. Here's Harrison in 1912 in the leading journal of the socialist movement, the International Socialist Review. Rudyard Kipling, you may be familiar with his very famous poem, "The White Man's Burden." Well, Harrison, later on we'll see. I think I have a passage from it coming up, but he will write a response, "The Black Man's Burden," right? But in this article, he takes up a challenge to Kipling. And he says, all this talk about the white man's burden, let's look at the facts. And then he goes bang, bang, bang. The International Socialist Review. And this book, this is also, you'll find, besides detailed coverage of this in the Hubert Harrison biography, in the book, A Hubert Harrison Reader, which we have here and we can show people later, these articles, I think most of these articles are included in his Socialist Party years and his class radicalism years. Okay. In contrast to Kipling's white man view, Harrison proposed to put forth views based on facts, political, economic, social, and education. He felt that those facts would furnish such a damning indictment as must open the eyes of the world. He writes another article in the International Socialist Review. This is part of the series. And this one, the 10 million Negroes of America form a group that is more essentially proletarian. And in that first session, and when you go back, if you look at the video, you're going to see this understanding of slavery as capitalist, slave owners as slavery as capitalism, slave owners as capitalists, and the plantation laborers, the bond laborers here in the U.S. as proletarians is crucial. We see it in Du Bois in Black Reconstruction, and we see it in Allen's work, and it's crucial. Allen makes the argument later on. With that understanding, we're able to learn some of the most heroic examples in the history of the working class, right? Because black labor is not excluded. You're able to tear the covers off white labor's betrayal of black labor, and Allen takes it further and says, with that understanding, you can also see the origin and the invention of the white race, which is what we'll talk about in the next session, right? All right, so Harrison suggested that the Socialist Party take up the Negro problem at its big convention in 1912, Indianapolis, right? He cited instances of racism within the party. He emphasized the party had to address the question. He phrased it this way: Southernism or socialism? What's going to be the direction of the party, right? Is it to be the white half of the working class against the black half, or all of the working class together? Can we hope to triumph over capitalism with one half of the working class against us? In that same article, he again puts forth his position that it's the duty of the party to champion the African Americans' cause. And as was pointed out in the first session, that precedes by a year Du Bois saying socialism is a crucial test, right, of the Negro. Negro question is a crucial test of socialism. So Harrison, again, is really a pioneer in a lot of this stuff. And that's one of the reasons it's so unfortunate we have not known more about him. Okay. At the Socialist Party convention, Harrison's laid it down. He goes, Southernism or socialism? What's it going to be? What's going to be the direction of the party? This is a crucial issue. They don't even discuss the Negro question at the convention. But they do discuss Asian immigration. And in the debate on Asian immigration, Socialist Party of America takes some of the most racist positions in the history of the U.S. left. And it was kind of an answer to Harrison's question. Both the majority and minority reports opposed Asian immigration. And it was published, you see some of the names. Here's Unterman, one of the names I showed earlier, right? And on Asian immigration, this is what the Socialist Party says. Majority position. Race fielding is not so much a result of social as of biological evolution. It is deeper than any class feeling and will outlast the capitalist system. Class consciousness must be learned, but race consciousness is inborn and cannot be wholly unlearned. That is the racism is innate argument that Harrison says is the core of all racist positions. And that's the party at the National Convention. In 1920, when Harrison's writing for the Negro World, you know, and there's this, all this talk about, you know, why don't you come, you know, and get back with the socialists and stuff like this, he brings this out and he goes, have you changed from this position yet? Have you changed from that? And of course they hadn't, right? Mm-hmm. So, here was the racism is innate argument. If race feeling was innate, then the SP was saying that corrective actions against racism would be minimal and little effect. Because those two arguments that I mentioned earlier, racism is innate and that white workers benefit. If racism is innate, why fight it? If white workers benefit by racism, why should they oppose it, right? We've got to understand the logic of these arguments. You got to go after it. We know the privileges exist, but it's poison bait. It's like a shot of heroin. It looks good, but it's not in your interest, right? 1912 campaign, Eugene Debs. He runs for president 5 times. Here he is, the call, so he's probably in New York in this photo, right? Big crowd. I didn't see Harrison in the photo, but you look. Mostly male. And I don't know if there's any African Americans, Afro-Caribbeans there. Debs on the Negro question was considered one of the better people in the party. He took a position that it's a class question, right? But that was considered one of the better positions. But he also argued that African Americans, because of their experience in slavery, were not yet the equal of whites. Their struggle was only part of the general labor struggle, no need for separate appeals. So these are not Harrison's positions, right? This is Debs, right? He argued that class struggle was colorless. We have groups today that make similar arguments, right? So Debs is arguing class struggle was colorless, no need for separate appeals. We know what Harrison's arguing. Special appeals to African Americans, draws from the work with foreigners and women, duty of all to oppose race prejudice, champion the cause as a revolutionary doctrine. It's got revolutionary impact and potential is what Harrison's arguing. That's what Allen will argue later. All right. In this period, Harrison is also an unrivaled soapbox orator. And one of these dates, this one, I had 1913 before, but it's 1912, so I'm calling your attention. I'm correcting one of the previous slide I showed you. I went back and I said, that's not right. So, and that'll happen, so we correct it as we can. He spoke as many as 23 times a week in that campaign for Debs in 1912. He was pouring his heart and soul into socialism, right? That's morning, noon, and night, 7 days a week. The New York Times, and again, some people have heard this, but on September 13th, he's down at Broad and Wall Street for 4 hours, as far as the voice can reach. The New York Times is writing about this, talking on socialism. That's the early Occupy Wall Street movement, right? That, unfortunately, the younger generation was not aware of, right? But it's important to know that, and you know, who kind of had that insight early, right? He speaks before 50,000 people at Union Square on May Day in 1912, and he spoke all over the city. Henry Miller, and I'll briefly show you again his account, but everyone who saw Harrison speaks describes him in various ways as an unrivaled orator, right? In this period, Harrison also is moving to the left wing in the party, right? He's moving constantly to the left wing. And the left wing of the party was often those in and around support for the IWW, the Industrial Workers of the World. The IWW called for one big union. They favored industrial unions, multi-craft unions, over exclusionary craft unions. They organized unskilled and unorganized workers. They advocated racial equality. One of their big defining issues was direct action. They believed in direct action. We're going to go out. We're going to take action. They supported sabotage, right, in the cause of, you know, struggle. They defended it. And they organized 25,000 Brotherhood of Timber Workers in the Deep South, interracial union, right? Unheard of, you know, relatively. So they tried to put into practice what they preached. Now, up here in the area where Harrison is in Northeast, they had some presence. They're involved, as people may know if they're familiar with some of the history, in the Lawrence textile strike. And a big one that they're involved in is Paterson, New Jersey, not far from here. And they still have, they have the American Labor Museum in Halden, right next to Paterson. And we've been out there a few times, and we've had a speaker go up and do a Harrison rendition of, because he spoke to the Paterson strikers. And according to the Paterson police, he was the most militant. But here, this is a wonderful photo. This is Hubert Harrison with Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, Big Bill Haywood, and some of the other orators, mostly IWW people from Paterson, the 1913 strike. They also have the big pageant here in New York. I mean, he's right in the forefront, and he's out. He speaks twice to the Paterson strikers, and he's active in the support committee because there's a big, there's division in the ranks of the Socialist Party because the dominant tendency in New York, the leadership, was trying to distance itself from the militancy of the Paterson strikers. Here's Henry Miller, who I mentioned previously, and I've shown this photo, who was a socialist in his youth. He's an autobiographical novelist. And he describes seeing Harrison at Madison Square. Madison Square is Madison Avenue and Park, 23rd to 27th Street, that little park there. People might remember it, right? And he saw him there. That's one of the places Harrison would speak. I believe Richard B. Moore saw him there also. Richard B. Moore, who had the Frederick Douglass bookstore and the famed Scottsboro Orator, was influenced deeply by Harrison. And there was no one in those days who could hold a candle to Hubert Harrison. With a few well-directed words, he had the ability to demolish any opponent. I described the wonderful way he smiled, his easy assurance, great sculptured head. I wondered aloud if he had not come from royal blood. He electrified by his mere presence. Besides him, the other speakers looked like pygmies, not only physically, but culturally and spiritually. No matter what the provocation, Harrison retained his self-possession, his dignity. He had a way of placing the back of his hand on his hip, his trunk tilted, his ears cocked to catch every last word. Well, how he knew to bide his time. after a comment or a heckler or a question, particularly if it was a heckler, he would respond, always fair and square, always full on like a broadside. Soon everyone would be laughing. That's one account of Harrison as an orator. Claude McKay gives another lengthy, brilliant one of, you know, Harrison, how people were so impressed. And in the biography, I have notes, both in the text and in the footnotes of others. Okay, so Harrison and the Socialist Party, he was trying to carry on special work aimed at African Americans, advocate for revolutionary socialism and industrial unionism, and he started running into problems with the Socialist Party. First off, he opposed some of their positions. They wouldn't even root Debs when Debs was running for president. They wouldn't even let him go down south, or they wouldn't schedule him down south because the meetings were going to be segregated, right? And then all of a sudden there's some disputes because Harrison's speaking out, right? And he's going to get less fees than some of the white socialist speakers at events and things like this. So he starts agitating about this and writing and gets brought up on some internal charges. And we have a history of some of what the back and forth on that. But the party leadership was firm. And although Harrison initiated the Colored Socialist Club and they did some work, right, had some meetings, right, they decided to end the Colored Socialist Club. So the party response was there would be no special agitational organization forms for African Americans. They tightened control over Harrison speaking. And the historian Winston James, who I've mentioned previously, an excellent historian, in his book, Holding Aloft the Banner of Ethiopia, about early 20th century Caribbean radicalism, concludes that American socialism did not keep faith with Hubert Harrison. Harrison kept faith with socialism, right? But this is also important because the way they treat Harrison has deeper effects, right? So the party denied not only his right to speak, but the right of individual members to schedule their own debates. This is a period, what happens, there's then a general tightening in the Socialist Party. There's a movement right. Not only were left-wing views opposed, but the left wing of the party was being driven out. Not only were special efforts for African Americans thwarted, efforts at autonomous activities by branches were also held in check. Most importantly, not only was Harrison attacked, his strategically important message against the struggle against white supremacy and the revolutionary potential of true democracy for African and equality for African Americans would not be heard for so many years. Though aimed at Harrison, as Harrison was leaving the party, I also wanted to comment what was happening then when they take it out on Harrison and the Colored Socialist Club. Within a matter of years, they start doing the same attack on women's clubs, right, on the women's branches and stuff like that. So you see the interrelation of the movements. All right, when Harrison leaves the Socialist Party, he argues what I have continually argued is what is arguably the most profound but least heeded criticism in the history of the U.S. left. He stated simply that the Socialist Party, like the labor movement, insisted on white race first and class after, that have put the white race first before class. And what I argue is, not only is that insightful, but that also points the way towards Allen's work on the invention of the white race. What is this white race, right? Harrison's also suggesting an answer to the question, why no socialism in this country? Why have we not had been more successful building an effective left, an effective socialist or communist movement? For Harrison, the primary reason for limited working class consciousness and absence of socialism was because white workers and socialists put white race first before class. Within a matter of years, he would soon respond by stressing that race first, race consciousness amongst African Americans was needed as a measure of self-defense and as a means of challenging white supremacy. We're going to get to that, right? So what he does when he leaves the Socialist Party, everybody's with me, right? 1914-15, he's going to go out on his own for a period. And he starts lecturing on free thought, free speech, birth control, and racial aspects of World War I. This is early, right? He, in his diary, and his diary is up there at Columbia, anybody wants to read it. And again, for those who are not aware, his 102-page finding aid of all his papers is available online. You can link to it from my page or you can from Columbia's library website. And when we placed the Harrison papers at Columbia, one of the provisions was that anyone could access them, right? So that's important to know. And if you go there and they give you a hard time, raise that, you know, and you've got my email. Contact me, any problem.
Jeff said we could do it.
Yeah, right. Mention my name. A momentous step. This is one entry from his diary, but I found this interesting because when I write the biography of Harrison, one of the things, I think if you're writing a biography, not that I'm an expert and I haven't written any before, but you've got to tell the whole story, warts and all, if you will. You know, this is how we're going to learn, right? Nobody's perfect. But sometimes you come across statements that are just shocking because here's Harrison, who's this extraordinary activist. He's already played this leading role in the Socialist Party, right? And he writes, September 28, 1914, he's out of the party, he goes, yesterday I began my career. He goes, heretofore, every step in my progress since I came to this country has been forced upon me. It's like he wasn't even carving his own path. It's always a matter, he goes, and excites them, you know, talking St. Benedict's Lyceum, some of the things we talked about, Branch 5 School, the Postal Service, the social. In these situations, even into marriage, I have either been drifted or been driven. This I owe to promptings of a friend, that to the enfoldment of circumstance which left me no other course, right? So he's trying to, you know, finally, you know, figure, well, what is it I want to do, you know, and how I want to take this? A little bit for all of us, you know, to think about and learn from, right? So when he speaks at the modern school, and the modern school in this period was up on East 107th Street, right? And it had been started a few years earlier by this Spanish anarchist named Francisco Ferrer. He was not in the U.S. He's killed in 1909, I believe, by church and state coming together, you know, and you know, having him executed in Spain. But the modern school tried to move away from rote learning. It was pro-self-expression, it was anti-capitalist cooperative, it was really a progressive education, right? And at the modern school, the staff included a lot of very progressive people. Emma Goldman, Alexander Hutchins Hapgood, these are known anarchists. Anarchist and freethought editor Leonard Abbott, we have his picture in the book, right? Single tax activist, a fellow named James F. Morton, who also later goes out to Patterson, and is very instrumental in setting up collections at the Patterson Museum.
What was the single tax movement? I see it mentioned in
another. Right. It was the single tax movement is from Henry George, right? Going back. And they was that was kind of the key for them, you know, a single tax on land, I believe.
I believe that only landowners should pay tax.
Right, right. And freethought writer James F. Morton, artist Robert Henry, George Bellows, and John Sloan. They're still active, by the way, and they have an office, yeah. I believe, on 28th Street and Park Avenue or something in New York, if you look them up. IWW labor agitator Elizabeth Gurley Flynn, William English Walling, muckrakers, philosopher, attorney, right? So they had a lot of very good people speaking at the modern school, and you see some of the topics. Anarchism, socialism, syndicalism, revolution, birth control, free love, cubism, Freudianism, new woman, new theater. This was all the cutting edge stuff, right, in this period. This is 100 years ago, right? And the modern school was an important focus of cultural and social ferment, and many of the seminal ideas of 20th century politics and art were being discussed there. In this period, Harrison, who had already broken from the church, the most powerful institution in the black community, writes one of his most pointed pieces on Christianity. And it's his 1914 version is "The Negro, a Conservative," but it's how Christianity, you know, contains and restricts the mind of the Negro along those lines. And Christian America created the colored line. And all the great currents of critical opinion found this great barrier impassable. It cloaked the beginnings of slavery. Church saw to it that the religion taught to slaves should stress servile virtues. Fight for abolition was on. Christian church gagged the mouths of their adherents who dared to protest. It opposed all who fought on the side of the Negro slave. Yet today the church exerts a more powerful influence than anything else in the sphere of ideas. Nietzsche's contention that the ethics of Christianity are the slave ethics would seem justified. It's pretty pointed critique, right? Show me a population that's deeply religious and I will show you a servile population. So he comes out smoking against the church. And this full article is in the Harrison Reader, right? The Negro, a conservative. Yeah, but you'll find it easy enough.
When you say the church, you mean what church?
He's talking in particular about Christianity and the Christian church, right?
What is the Christian church?
Well, it's Protestantism, Catholicism, you know. Christianity. He's right now, I mean, he's not talking about, in that case right there, particularly. I mean, he's talking about Christianity is what he's talking about. In this period, Harlem casino talks. He's also speaking now in Harlem. And he develops the embryo of this race-conscious message that he will be propounding over the next years. And what's key to this, he thinks, because he's an internationalist, Harrison's an internationalist also, is World War I, which he thought helped to liberate many ideas undreamt of previously by so many. And democracy was a prime example. Here we come back to democracy. Remember, democracy is the touchstone? And if you recall from that first session, I talked about the twofold character of democracy. When it's a lily white supremacist democracy, it's a retardant for progressive change. But when it's thoroughgoing democracy, it's a catalyst for social change. So here's what Harrison writes of democracy. During World War I, democracy was widely advertised as a convenient camouflage behind which competing imperialists masked their sordid aims. George Bush going to bring democracy to Iraq after the weapons of mass destruction doesn't work. The current situation, right? Those who proclaim new democratic demands most loudly never had any intention of extending them. But the call for democracy soon came back to plague those who were pushing it. And he refers to it as the cant of democracy. And please pay attention right here. He writes, while the cant of democracy, a cant is an insincere, repetitive chant, while the cant of democracy was intended as dust in the eyes of white voters, dust in the eyes, Du Bois talks about the American blind spot. Allen, when he starts writing about white privilege, writes about the white blind spot, dust in the eyes, an important, important concept. We see it here in Harrison. And he goes, and bait for the clever statesman, right? This, running bait. There's that poison bait again that we see later, so, you know, in Allen, right? And the oppressed millions took democracy at its base value, which is equality, and people started demanding, well, let's make that the case. Thus, while the white world played with democratic slogans, it simultaneously and ruthlessly ruled the overwhelming majority of the world, black, brown, and yellow, for whom democracy was never meant to apply. The resultant double standard was evident when whites insisted upon the right to control their ancestral lands. Think about this one. It was called democracy. But when blacks, Hindus, and Egyptians sought to control their land, it was called impudence, right? You know, and we have, of course, the current situation again. Harlem, all right. Harrison is writing in this period, as far back as 1915, he's writing and lecturing on the racial aspects of World War I. He makes two predictions in that early period. One is that on an international level, the European conflict for colonial possessions would awaken racial and national consciousness in the non-white world. Which it does, right? And white Europe would sow seeds of its own destruction, right? So this is what he's foreshadowing. On a domestic level, he predicts that the sweeping tide of racial consciousness that ultimately found expression in Negro newspapers and magazines called radical, that would be one effect of it. And he warned that there would be repercussions for a war fought for racial supremacy in which democracy, they were told the struggle was over democratic ideals. So he sees both international and domestic implications of this war. Now, this passage from Harrison on war, I mean, I break it down. This is all paragraphs and neatly done. But it is one of the most profound critiques of capitalism, imperialism. It's very similar in so many respects to when Lenin writes about imperialism, right? And of course, and that was, you know, Lenin's work in that period was a major dividing line in the left movement internationally, right? But Harrison writes, it is the same economic motive that has been back of every modern war since the merchant trading class has secured the powers of the modern state. It is a natural and inevitable effect of the capitalist system. That system is based upon the wage relationship between those who own and operate, and between those who own and those who operate the gigantic forces of land and machinery. Under this system, no capitalist employs a worker for $2 a day unless that worker creates more than $2 a day. Out of this surplus can profits come. If 10 million workers could thus create $100 million and get 25, well, it is obvious they can expect only what they have received, and that therefore every nation whose industrial system is organized on a capitalist basis must produce a mass of surplus products. And within the last week, there's been talk about this again, about the potential dangers between this divide, this big gap between rich and poor. If you've seen, and if you really, I mean, although it's been hot in the major press in this country in the last week, this divide and how poor people don't have enough money to buy it, I recommend on my webpage, top left, my article, The Developing Conjuncture, I talk about how when you have this growing gap between rich and poor, what really develops is what's called a crisis of overproduction, because they can produce anything they want. They can produce, but people don't have the money to buy it, right? And of course, that leads to economic crisis, you know, over time, right? So it is obvious that they can expend only what they have received. Before the products can return to their owners as profit, they must be sold somewhere. Hence the need for foreign markets in spheres of influence in undeveloped countries whose resources can also be exploited. But since every industrial nation is seeking the same outlet for its products, clashes are inevitable. Armies and navies must come into play. Hence, the exploitation of white men in Europe and America becomes the reason for the exploitation of black, brown, and yellow men in Africa and Asia. Therefore, it is hypocritical and absurd to pretend that the capitalist nations can ever intend to abolish war. So it's a pretty strong critique. In this period, Harrison also briefly writes a couple pieces for Cyril Briggs's Colored American Review. Briggs would become known later on, some people may know, he founds the African Blood Brotherhood. He's later long active with the Communist Party, right? Let's see. Here's where his poetic, it was in the Colored American Review, the paper of Briggs, that Harrison writes his poem, Black Man's Burden. It's much longer than this, but it's in both books, so you can find it, right? Both the biography and the reader. And it's his response, his poetic response to Rudyard Kipling. And it's quite good, actually. And you'll be able to read it, the excerpt online, when you see the video. All right. In this period, a woman named Gertrude Cohn, who works at the 135th Street Public Library, and James Weldon Johnson, whom people may know, a very famous figure in black history, did the Negro National Anthem, but he's active with the NAACP, he's an ambassador, rich history, right? They both suggest that Harrison should bring all his talents and skills and concentrate them in the black community, right? She's working at the 135th Street Public Library. That's what grows into the Schomburg Center, right? And here's what James Weldon Johnson writes in the New York Age. New York Age was New York's leading black newspaper at that time. He writes an article called Open Air Lecture Course in Harlem. He's calling for an open air, outdoor speaking in Harlem, right? And he goes, this would serve as a university extension carried to the farthest point. And again, this is one thing I want to encourage people to think about, to discuss with their friends, because we got these parks, we got these public spaces, and we can be using them as they were used 100 years ago. And this is where you bring people, you know, might not be reading and this and that, but we come together and we talk and we hear and we exchange ideas. But this would serve as a university extension carried to the farthest and could attract people on the street who wouldn't go to a lecture, but who would listen if a lecture was brought to them. Johnson recommended Harrison. He said Harrison would give a series of lectures that would be more than equivalent to a year of college and of incalculable benefit to the community. So he's being encouraged and pushed. It's James Weldon Johnson. But is another thing that goes into Harrison's decision to turn to concentrated work in the black community. And again, all this stuff I think is so important because it's the question of art. And he uses art as the frontier. And here's how this one goes. In this period, around 1917, Harlem is up to about 50,000 people, but it's not all black yet. I mean, or not mostly black, as it would become after a period of time. But the IRT has been completed, 1904, right? So there's a movement of people up to Harlem. Harrison set himself the task of analyzing if Negro society was in any sense distinct from American society. A task similar to what Nathan Huggins, who's a historian who I knew, a very fine historian, recalls the recurring task of Negro intellectuals to delineate Negro character and personality in the American context. Harrison had previously analyzed economic, political, social, and economic aspects. He now attempted to analyze the psychology of the Negro. His entrance was through the frontier of art. He would apply his finely honed critical skills. He began writing a book on Negro society and the Negro stage. Charles Gilpin is the leading black actor of his day. This is before Paul Robeson. When Emperor Jones' play comes out, he has the lead, the first lead. Later, it's Paul Robeson, you know. He performs with the Anita Bush Stock Company, which is, and the Lafayette Players, the two real pioneering groups, black theater groups up in Harlem, right? And Harrison begins arguing that the Negro theater revealed the social mind of the Negro. So here's some of what he says on this topic. The status of the Negro actor is determined by the status of his own social group and in turn determines the relation he shall maintain to his public, be that public black or white. It decrees that in playing before white audiences, he, the Negro actor, must appear only in Negro roles and must strive at his peril to present their conception of what a Negro is or should be. So only can he be secure of securing that measure of success upon which, you know, so only by doing that can he get a job, right? Basically is what he's saying, right? Or hold a job. Mm. Since the black playgoers were creatures of their times, their very notions of self and group were built upon models derived from the larger world, thus the dialectical relationship. To Harrison, the black actor and the black playwright, in order to survive financially, selected those aspects that their audience would accept. But before a black audience, the black actor had a choice to either play to that conception of life and its stage presentation, which they had derived from white people, or to play to the higher ideals from the lives they actually live, right? The first choice was neither high nor a serious one, and the second choice offered little hope of remuneration, of getting paid, right? But he says, here is where you had some contributions from, particularly he gets talking about the black actor. Given this situation, there were definite contributions made by the black actor and the black playwright. Negro vaudevillians were a case in point. They played before white and black audiences. They played to one view or the other. But Harrison saw, and whether they played to one view or the other, they could not avoid making their art the vehicle of social criticism. He's talking about how black actors had a role to play even in this context, right? And he saw that role of tremendous significance since it elicited and reflected the actual flow of common life. Thus, even passing quips and seemingly idle gestures with a certain index of social situations, and the black audience would oftentimes pick up on this, white audience might be oblivious. It was especially in this that the artistic value of black playwrights and comedians was manifested. Both consciously and unconsciously, they presented aspects of Negro life. A prime example he uses back then was this actor, a comedian, called String Beans, who often sang a humorous little song which went, and it usually ended, and whatever it is brown skin. String Beans forced the phrase on audience at the end of every second line. The repetitive emphasis, Harrison showed, argued Harrison, that the dramatic and comic value of the refrain was solely in the fact that color was a great social obsession among our Negroes. Thus, with other things equal, one's social value in this group is in direct ratio to one's white lightness. A fact with many implications as to Negro character. This was a point of departure as Harrison moved to what he considered the real essence of his argument. He wanted to probe the issue of color prejudice within the race, because he's trying to move to a kind of a black is proud position, right? You know, a pride in Negro, that was the word, as opposed to color back then, right? As he explained, it was common to hear black speakers lecturing white audiences on the evil of color prejudice, all the while ignoring that there is no such thing as color prejudice, I mean race prejudice it would be, except among colored people. And then on the black stage, he says there were chromatically select circles where very black women were particularly discriminated against. In black society, one could hear references to good color, good hair. Such phrases ran the gamut from tantalizing browns to high yellows. Harrison described hearing talk of high color and, other phrases, right, and disparaging loads of coal. He pointed out that the N-word is heard more frequently among Negroes themselves than among white people. And all this, Harrison argued, reinforced the fact that the craze for color runs deep in Negro society. And the mulatto thinks himself superior to the black or brown person, and this results in a silent ostracism of the blacks, which can be made very galling. This social separatism displays its most striking organized form in the churches, such as St. Philip's in New York and Francis James Grimsky's 15th Street Church in Washington. What's interesting about this St. Philip's in New York is, although Harrison wasn't religious, his wife was, and that's the church she went to. So, yeah, So this is Harrison, and he's probing at this stuff, right? And he will write, and he's going to continue to write, but he's not doing it mean-spirited. He's trying, because earlier we see in the NA, when he's talked about the NAACP, he's making the argument that a touch of white blood doesn't preordain somebody to be leader of the Negro race, right? So Hodge Kiernan, whose photo I will show you again in a little bit, and whose photo I had shown you previously from Montserrat, a very insightful commentator in the period, talks about how Harrison was able to his discursive mind, made it possible for him to appreciate and evaluate the drama, music, and other forms of expression as manifestations of the social characteristics of the age. Because of this, Harrison was always able to catch glimpses of truth and new ideas and to interpret them in their ideological and practical aspects. So he was able to draw from everyday life, offer insights and bring it back and break it down, kind of. All right, now moving into Harrison's radicalism even deeper. A. Philip Randolph, Harrison's talking on the racial aspects of the war. He's got that socialist background. A. Philip Randolph follows him. Randolph will go on to describe Harrison as the father of Harlem radicalism in the period when Harlem is considered the center of radical black thought. Randolph is a follower of Harrison's. Chandler Owen, who's Randolph's partner, right? They're active together, Randolph and Owen. Owen and Randolph was also a follower of Harrison, but he was more of a class first socialist, and he actually debates Harrison over this in late 1917. Harrison starts articulating, and this is very important, a new new in terms of this left movement, concept of race unity from the bottom up. It is not Booker T. Washington with the Tuskegee machine. It is not W.E.B. Du Bois and the Talented Tenth, right? He says, no, you're starting at the wrong end. You've got to light the fire at the bottom. They have begun at the top when it should have begun at the bottom. To unite the intellectuals is not the same as uniting the Negro masses. And we'll see this, of course, more in Garvey later on, right? Or Malcolm, right? Interestingly, in his 1940 autobiography, W.E.B. Du Bois reaches a similar conclusion. He says, I was wrong back then, when I'm arguing. And you'll find that, and I've got the exact cites in my book, right? I believe in a biography. But on this one, actually, it may be coming out in volume two, but Apthecker, who's a chronicler of the life of Du Bois, if it's not in the volume, I'll get it to you because I have it at home because it may be in volume two, yes.
There's also a good article on Wikipedia, and they quote from Du Bois' son saying that he changed his mind.
That's interesting, and I will go to that because when Apthecker cites it, when Apthecker, who chronicled the life, he doesn't give a source, so it may be the son. No, that's good. Thank you so much. Going on. So 1916-17, this is the birth of the militant New Negro Movement. Now again, this New Negro Movement, this is 16 and 17, that's 8-9 years before Alain Locke and the middle class, arts-based New Negro Movement that we've heard and that is the canon, the canonical teaching about the new Negro, right? And so this is the birth of it in this period, and the movement that Harrison's going to be building and leading in building is race conscious, it's internationalist, it's mass based, it's geared towards the common people. I can't stress that enough. You read, you'll see in volume two, I'll elaborate on this much more, but in the Harrison Reader, he's got a wonderful essay on the common people with affection, right? About these are the real forces, and they're, you know, true to the cause. He's going to be advocating for political equality, social justice, civic opportunity, economic power, defense of self, family, and race in the face of lynching and white supremacy. That relates to your ongoing debate with your friend, defense. All right. War and the race consciousness. Harrison takes, again, contemporary themes, and he breaks them down. There's a building here in Lower Manhattan, which I should have taken a photo of, because I don't know if I remember where it is, but I will look for it. But if anybody here comes across it again, please let me know. We're up on the higher floors. You know, they have sometimes the old faded advertisements on the buildings. For you need a biscuit. That was the big biscuit of the National Biscuit Company 100 years ago, right? It was the common crack, you know, that was, and they did pioneering sales, advertising, promotion sales of their product. And it was called You Need a Biscuit. The message is you need a biscuit, right? And by virtue of its great advertising campaign for democracy held out to people, the war fertilized the race consciousness of the Negro. It nurtured that which bloomed in the hearts of the Negro masses. Harrison writes an article on You Need a Biscuit and says, well, if you keep telling the people you need a biscuit, they're going to take you at your word, right? If you keep telling them they need democracy, you know, World War I is a war fought for democracy, according to Woodrow Wilson, right? We're going to go make the world safe for democracy. You keep telling them they need democracy, they're going to start listening and believe it. Say, yeah, segregation, lynching, disfranchisement. All right, so in 1917, Harrison starts articulating a race-first response to the white-first of the socialists. That core message, which became more pronounced during World War I, would remain a political staple. As he explained, by virtue of this great advertising campaign for democracy and the promises held out to subject peoples, it fertilized the race consciousness of the Negro people. It chiseled the channels of race consciousness deeper among American Negroes than previous external circumstances, and it nurtured that which bloomed in the hearts of the Negro masses. Racialism, race consciousness, race solidarity. Race consciousness, that would become the center of his strategic perspective for the remaining years of his life. Basically a call to African Americans to recognize the racial oppression they face and to use that awareness to unite, organize, and respond as a group. This was necessary, he concluded, because white American labor and white people were pronouncedly anti-Negro. So this is going to be the direction he's going to go, you know, for his last decade or so. And sometimes in the early period, the phrase race first is used. He also uses race consciousness and more as he goes on. And I get into some distinctions between the two. In the book, I may have something here. But he nowhere clarifies fully, you know, differences and stuff like this. But again, the phrase here, racialism, race consciousness, racial solidarity, he will use in several instances, right? Overall, Harrison's advocating a proactive policy, not dependent on whites, go to mobilize Negroes' political power, economic power, intellectual power, things that are within the Negroes' control without depending upon or waiting for white people. For those who were here last week when we talked about the NAACP founding meeting, and Harrison says that that's no way, we can't found this organization on white people's expectations of black people's, of what, how black people should act. And the NAACP in the early period, he argues, has no answer to the question, what are you going to do if white people don't act the way you think they should be acting, right? You know, so Harrison's not going to wait around. He's going to be proactive. And this is partly from that left-wing experience, you know, with the IWW types, but even going back further, it's from his St. Croix, his Crucian roots, direct action. You know, we're not going to just sit around. We're going to take action to try and address these problems. Richard B. Moore, one of the, a longtime friend of Harrison, influenced deeply by Harrison, turns to soapbox oratory under Harrison's influence. His daughter, Joyce Moore Turner, still, I spoke with her 2-3 days ago, 92, still writing wonderful books on this, excellent. Joyce Moore Turner, remember that name. Richard B. Moore, Communist Party, African Blood Brotherhood, Socialist Party, Scottsboro Orator, Frederick Douglass Bookstore on 125th Street, and many other things. Here's the founding meeting of Harrison's Liberty League, the first organization of the new Negro movement. The date is June 12, 1917, Bethel AME Church, 132nd Street, right? Here's the slogan, stop lynching and disfranchisement. Make the South safe for democracy. Wilson's saying, let's make the world safe. Harrison says, let's make the South safe for democracy. Speakers, Hubert Harrison, Chandler Owen, that's Randolph's buddy, Adam Clayton Powell Sr., and Harrison invites Garvey up. Garvey's first major talk, right? Harlem crowd. Significant, significant date and event. Harrison's Liberty League is going to focus on democracy and equality. They're going to oppose lynching, segregation, disfranchisement. They advocate your basic civil rights legislation, which takes years more, right, to get at least in nominally in law. Enforcement of 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment. Federal anti-lynching legislation. I'm coming back to this. Very important. A political voice. There were no black elected officials in New York at this time, right? They want to start demanding, making political demands, uniting black community to, you know, push for demands. And the political voice also comes from a quote from Woodrow Wilson in that period. And Harrison uses that on the front page of his newspaper, The Voice, sometime, because he's demanding a political voice, right? Black community. And Harrison's Liberty League advocates militant armed self-defense. 1917, publicly, streets of New York. 1920s, he goes out to Patterson and challenges the Klan, who are growing in Jersey, openly, right? Tulsa erupts in Harrison in 1921, and Harrison's writing and putting out things. He's unabashed in his call for armed self-defense. And this is many years before Robert F. Williams, 1961, right? The Federal Lynching League demands federal anti-lynching legislation. Now, I mentioned this in the first session, but the NAACP, most people not familiar with this history, although it opposed lynching, it did not advocate federal anti-lynching legislation. And the reason why is the one that Harrison had warned about. They didn't want to alienate Southern white support. Why is federal anti-lynching legislation important? Because if you have it, you have a chance to get some justice. You don't get that situation like the Emmett Till case when the culprits walk into the courtroom joking, knowing they're walking out, you know, nothing happened to them. So the NAACP was reaching for Southern support, and I cite documents. You know, the historian of the NAACP and a fellow who writes a book on the NAACP and lynching, right? Armed self-defense. Liberty League would call upon some people to defend themselves against murder, particularly in the face of mob violence. The Liberty League's declaration came from an international perspective. It explained how some of this growing consciousness grew out of the events of World War I, and particularly the call for democracy, the right of people to ruin their own ancestral lands. In such an era of revolutionary ferment all over the world, the Liberty League reasoned, Negro Americans must voice our demands for equal justice, protection, and opportunity. So he's taking advantage of this situation of war. People are being asked to sacrifice, go get their lives and stuff like that. Much change internationally, domestically, people, you know, coming out of the South, period of the Great Migration, war industry, right? Harrison explained that during the war, and Harrison goes into this and explains a little, black troops who knew little of the outside world, right? Particularly if you're down south, you have very limited experience going other places for the most part, right? That they came to know that there were some white men in the world to whom a dark face was not an invitation to be mean and nasty. They met other people from Senegal, Cochin China, that's Indochina, I believe, correct? Cape Colony, India and Egypt. They learned that the essential similarity of their sufferings, and this is a phrase he uses, the similarity of their sufferings, and sentiments in the shadow of that color line that ran from Boston to Benares and from Tulsa to Shenzhen, right, I guess. This was a new crusade, and as in the early one, the multiplication of contacts was the multiplication of culture. On domestic issues, he's saying this is the time to make bold our bid for some of that democracy which we need. And he talks in particular about disfranchisement of 10 million Negroes, how that cannot be reconciled with any idea of liberty. And they push forth the demands to end the twin evils of lynching and disfranchisement. Over 100 black people a year are still being lynched at this period, right? There's Hodge Cannon, who I mentioned earlier, and we had one quote, but he emphasizes, and this is important to understand about Hubert Harrison, he lives with and amongst the people. 231 West 134th Street, most densely populated block in Harlem. He's of the people, he's not on high. And Cannon says that Harrison's voice, his newspaper, The Voice, crystallized the radicalism of the Negro in New York. It exerted a tremendous influence in inspiring people. Harrison lived with and amongst the people, taught the masses, and drew much of his inspiration from them. It's a two-way street. He's learning from the people, too, right? And that Harrison was the first Negro whose radicalism was comprehensive enough to include racialism, politics, theological criticism, sociology, and education in a thoroughgoing and scientific manner. This is a poem about Harrison. It appears in The Crusader, another publication of Cyril Briggs, by Andy Razaf. Andy Razaf is one of the leading poets of the New Negro Movement. He also later on writes for Fats Waller, UB Blake. I mean, lyrics for 2,000 songs are tremendously talented, but very political, right? Lyricist and poet. July 1917, Harrison's just founded the Liberty League. He's talking about armed self-defense, and this is East St. Louis, right? What happens? It's on the Mississippi, war, it's migration time, you know, people coming up looking for jobs in the war industries, and there are attacks, racial pogroms on the African American community of East St. Louis, right? And They're inflamed by Samuel Gompers, the head of the AFL, and by a fellow named Carter, who's the head of one of the railroad brotherhoods. Keep these, you know, about taking white men's jobs, right? These black workers come to take white men's jobs. Harrison says, you know, what are white men's jobs? So in this particular picture, you have a streetcar, and you have a black man in front of the streetcar being attacked by a mob of whites while the National Guard stand around and do nothing. And in the reports that came out later, it was, you know, found as evidenced here that they had been, you know, had done a horrible job in maintaining peace and preserving people's lives and stuff like that. And actually at times were supporting the rioters. So again, Harrison pushing self-defense, and it's related to all his demands for both defense of family, self, and people, and the influences of direct action, the political voice demand. This is the quote from Wilson, and I was referring to the right of those who submit to authority to have a voice in their own government. So Wilson's preaching this stuff, right? You know, as we go into war, and Harrison says, let's take him at his word, right? And Harrison emphasizes the international duty to the 1,700 millions who are colored, black, and brown, and who seek to live free from the domination. He emphasized continually, we're ready to affiliate with similar organizations of darker races every place. In July 4th, 1917, they prepare a petition to go to the House of Representatives. It's opposed to lynching, Jim Crowism, segregation, and disfranchisement, and cites examples, and they want to, you know, compelling of several states. He says, they plan through the nation shall justify the world her assertions of democracy by setting free the millions of Negroes in the South through the enactment of laws which will either take the Negro under direct protection by Congress by making lynching a federal crime or compelling several states which now deprive the Negroes of their right to self-government to give them suffrage. He's looking for federal intervention. You're not getting anything from those states down South, right? This is very interesting. This is the tricolor flag of Hubert Harrison's Liberty League. The colors are black, brown, and yellow. And he explains why. Three colors, black, because they are symbolic of the three colors of the Negro race in America. But also, they are symbolic of people of color worldwide, right? So he's got that. From this tricolor flag, and I have more on this in the book you can read, Marcus Garvey would later, according to Harrison, draw the idea for the tricolor flag that his organization, the UNIA, would popularize. The red, black, and green, right? Harrison offers some comments on that decision, right? Harrison's advocating that what is needed is race-first leadership. This is what the black masses need in this period, right? Melville Charlton was another person active in Harrison's organizations. He's a very talented organist uptown, right? And he stays active with Harrison through the years, a close personal friend. Here's another publication put out by members of the New Negro called The Clarion in 1917. Harrison's organization, the Liberty League, Marcus Garvey joins the Liberty League. As I've stated before, people familiar with Garvey's history, he's really not one to join anyone else's organization, but he joins Harrison's Liberty League. Got to just talk briefly in a couple of slides on Harrison's influence on Garvey. This is Anselmo Jackson, who wrote for both The Voice and The Negro World, the Garvey paper. He goes, beginning in 1916, Hubert Harrison was preaching an advanced type of radicalism. The followers of Harrison, responding to his demand that a new Negro manhood movement among Negroes be organized, formed the Liberty League a short while prior to Garvey. The atmosphere was charged with Harrison's propaganda. Men of women of color throughout the U.S. and the West Indies donated their dollars and pledged their support. Garvey publicly eulogized Harrison, joined the Liberty League, and took a keen interest in its affairs. Harrison rendered memorable educational and constructive service. It can be truly said that he was the forerunner of Garvey and contributed largely to the success of the latter by preparing the minds of Negroes through his lectures and molding and developing a new temper among Negroes, which undoubtedly made the task of the Jamaican much easier. W.A. Domingo, Garvey's boyhood friend, the first editor of Garvey's Negro World, said Garvey came at the psychological moment. Before him, there was Hubert Harrison. He was a brilliant man, a great intellectual, a socialist, and highly respected. Garvey, like the rest of us, followed Hubert Harrison. William H. Ferris, assistant editor of the Negro World, Garvey rapidly crystallized Harrison's ideas. Here's Joel A. Rogers, author of World's Great Men of Color and other very important works. One of the men very much influenced by Harrison was Garvey. Garvey's emphasis on racialism was due in no small measure to Harrison's lectures on Negro history and his utterances on racial pride. Garvey movement was fructified, was nurtured by the spirit and teaching of Harrison. From the Liberty League and The Voice came the core progressive ideas and leaders later utilized by Garvey in both the Universal Negro Improvement Association and Negro World. In the biography, I do chapters and I list by name their role in Harrison's organization and their subsequent role in Garvey's organization. W.A. Domingo was an officer of the Liberty League and then becomes editor of the Negro World. Now, on the movement from Harrison to Garvey, I'm just going to offer a little here, but again, it's discussed in detail in the biography. Political reasons accelerated the move from the Liberty League. First, Harrison was extremely militant on the racial and imperialist implications of the war and on domestic matters. Distancing. One thing about Garvey I want to mention, people may not be familiar, but when he first comes to the U.S., he's kind of an adherent to Booker T. Washington, right? And he's actually planning to go back to Jamaica when Domingo, as the story goes, brings him to see Harrison and see Harrison's appeal on the corners and stuff. And that's a major factor in causing Garvey to decide to stay, right? Harrison's militant stance on the race. Harrison later pointed out that when The Voice appeared, it was the first and only the paper to say fight back in the face of mob attack. This bold position in wartime America was a difficult path for anyone to follow, right? His militant political stance was a principal reason that some of the followers went to Garvey. Garvey, you know, wasn't so associated with these militant positions in this early period, right? And Garvey, according to Richard B. Moore, whose photo I showed you earlier, whose daughter writes, was not as aggressive then as he later became, and he was soon able to organize with some of the dissidents from Harrison's Liberty League. But let me say a little more. The two main groups of people in and around Harrison who moved towards Garvey were those with political aspirations and those with entrepreneurial, with business aspirations. Harrison more radical, right, you know? So according to Moore, the other radicals did not consider Garvey very radical in this period, right, still. So with Garvey, there was a chance to turn, for those interested in political aspirations, with Garvey's UNIA, there was a chance to turn the organization toward political funding, particularly if organizational control could be obtained, right? Some who wanted to run for office, right? And Harrison had already shown that despite internal opposition, he would maintain control of Garvey. So what happens in Garvey's organization, people may not know this, but he loses control of the UNIA for a period. right, 1918. And it's Sam Duncan, I believe, is, I think he's from Jamaica also, I'm not sure, Samuel Duncan. But the attorney, Louis Laval, he's from Barbados. These people are going to run for office. They're going to run for political office. And in 1924, Isaac Allen. So these are a host of people, and they actually succeed. I don't know if I have it here on this slide, but they succeed in taking over the leadership of Garvey's organization for a period until Garvey responds with some legal actions and some physical threat or intimidation of Duncan, and reasserts control. Others who left the Liberty League or its periphery to go with Garvey were those with entrepreneurial aspirations. Domingo, whose photo I showed, who had an import, a West Indian import-export business, right? The former postal worker, Edgar Gray, Charles Seaford. Charles Seaford's a very important name. Harrison talks about him later because Harrison claims, and Seaford was both in Harrison's organization and went with Garvey. Harrison says he was the one who had the idea for what became the Black Star Line for the international shipping line and things like that. According to J. Dominic Simmons, among the first to go were these people. Seaford.
The idea for the
Seaford, Charles Seaford, yeah. And, I'm going right here from memory, but I have it all detailed, very, very meticulously documented in the biography, right?
Okay.
While some move people towards Garvey, it is one thing I want to emphasize, though, and I get this from when I was writing my dissertation way back. One of my advisors was a fellow named Hollis Lynch. See, people may know he wrote the biography of Blyden. He edited Garvey and Garveyism when it came out from Athenaeum in the late 60s from Tobago, Trinidad and Tobago, an outstanding historian. Back now, lives up here in New York now again. And his daughter is the filmmaker who has done a thing on Shirley Chisholm and a few other things. Very talented, you know. And Hollis Lynch emphasized to me, he goes, Jeff, it's important to emphasize to your audience in this period, when Harrison's Liberty League would be holding meetings, you know, in 135th Street, Garvey might be right down the hall, starting 2 hours later, and you know, there would be a flow of people to both, you know, just like here. This might be interesting to you now, but in 2 hours, if there was something down the hall, you might go to that one too. There was a lot of movement, right? It wasn't all so one-sided. So, and it was not like Garvey just came and swept people from Harrison. It was much more involved, and I go into that, right? It was a two-way street in the early period, that there was influence going both ways. The Liberty League, the voice and the activist around the two played particularly important roles in Garvey's decision to stay in the U.S. and in his developing ideas and organization. And the RASF again, race first attitude. Okay, here's the last thing I'm going to talk about today, and this will bring us up to the end. And I'm willing to stay for questions if people really want to stay. This is the Liberty Congress. This is the major black protest effort in World War I. Harrison is the co-chair with William Monroe Trotter, longtime black activist, founder of the Niagara Movement, you know, opponent of Booker T with Du Bois. As I mentioned in the earlier session, people remember when Harrison first comes, he basically considers himself a Du Bois man as opposed to Booker T. But, you know, he starts identifying differences he has also. All right. Here is a picture of the Congress, the Liberty Congress. This is in late June 1918. Men and women from 35 states, very important, men and women, they come together to push their demands for enforcement of 13th, 14th, 15th Amendment federal anti-lynching legislation, right? They're pushing progressive demands in wartime. They meet from June 24th to June 29th. You see the picture of Harrison right there? That's William Monroe Trotter. And that picture of Harrison, he's not playing. He's quite serious and stuff like this. And sometimes people ask, well, you know, even in the late 60s, when there was a renewed interest in black studies and stuff like this, why wasn't Harrison picked up a little more? And I'm going to go into that in great detail in Volume 2. But one of the reasons, I think, you know, we've talked about he's radical on so many things, but there are other images they'd like to portray rather than that one, because he's not playing, I think. It's just, I think there's very powerful forces that influence what history we get taught. And Harrison is quite serious and determined, right? The Liberty Congress gained national attention by petitioning Congress for federal legislation against lynching. Harrison addressed the subject of black leadership He was particularly troubled by the role that Du Bois played at the Liberty Congress. Now, when they have the Liberty Congress, they also petition Congress for the federal anti-lynching legislation.
What role did Du Bois play?
Okay. So now what happens in World War One? The first major issue, one of the first major issues that really generated a lot of interest and discussion in the black community was the question of officers' training camps. Black people are being asked to go fight and give up their lives in the war, and they wanted to be officers, like, you know, white people were being officers, and they wanted integrated camps. They didn't want to be treated, you know, differently. And according to Charles Flint Kellogg, who writes History of the NAACP, Volume 1, Volume 2 never came out after he wrote the first volume, right? He says the black community, because there's a lot of black newspapers now growing in this period, right? The black press was hammering away at this issue, and they were on the verge of winning when the NAACP, in the person of Joel E. Spingarn, said, "We'll accept the segregated camp." We, speaking on behalf of the black community. Spingarn's European American, he's not African American. NAACP did not have a black national head for its first 10 years, right? Spingarn is a few other things. He's a socialist, but he is a pro-war socialist. Lenin says during World War I, the dividing line in the international socialist movement was between the pro-war socialists and those who, you know, opposed the war. He's a couple of other things too. He's a Romance language professor up at Columbia University, but he is a major in military intelligence. Listen to what I'm saying. Here he is. I use this picture because here he is in his military uniform, just so you get clear. Military intelligence is that branch of the government that monitors the black and the radical community. It's like COINTELPRO 50 years later. What's also important to realize and to discuss with friends is to this day, the NAACP gives their annual award for outstanding achievement by a black American in his name. It's called the Spingarn Medal. Still to this day. Right? All right. He is also, he's another thing.
But also, he was an agent.
Yeah.
He gave up all the information of the membership to the government.
Yeah. Now, here's one other thing. He is also, by Du Bois' own admission, Du Bois' closest white friend, you know, because he had some power, influence, money, you know. So the first issue was the segregated camps, right? But then came the Liberty Congress. And we'll get to, okay, what Spingarn wants to do is he doesn't want that Liberty Congress to be held because this is going to be a militant position. They're going to raise issues that he doesn't want raised. And so he tries to get to Trotter to call it off. He doesn't even waste time trying to get to Harrison, right? He has no success. So then he falls to Plan B. Plan B is to hold a colored editors conference to meet the week before the Liberty Congress in Washington, D.C. to try and steal the thunder from the Liberty Congress. And at that, they do hold the colored Liberty Congress, but it is an all-male affair, no women, unlike the Liberty League. And Spingarn is there, Du Bois is there, but they have other people, including, and this is another one important for us knowing our history, including people like Frederick Delano Roosevelt, who later becomes president, who at that time is, I believe, assistant secretary to the Navy and taking great pride in having personally drafted so much of the Constitution of Haiti, the occupied Constitution of Haiti, right? And people don't know that, you know, about FDR. They don't know his role in this early period. But it was not an all-black affair, but it was an all-mayor affair, and it was to steal the thunder. And they hold that Liberty Congress. And they try to get Trotter to call off. So, and that doesn't work. Now, in the process of doing this, something else happens, too. Du Bois is talked to by Spingarn. Du Bois makes his own decision. But what Du Bois does in this period, please listen, is W.E.B. Du Bois. Now, Booker T. Washington has passed away. People are looking to Du Bois to be the paramount leader, right? You know, man of prestige, scholarship, you know, a history, you know, of militant struggle. And Du Bois puts in an application for a captaincy in military intelligence. This is the period he's most embarrassed about in his whole life. He puts in an application for a captaincy in military intelligence, but he does more. In order to seal the deal, the quid pro quo, he writes, close ranks. It is the editorial he's most embarrassed about his entire life. It appears in the July 1918 Crisis Magazine, the organ of the NAACP, right? It's only one paragraph long, so you can take a look here. Here we go. Let us, while this war lasts, forget our special grievances. He had defined special grievances 2 months earlier. Lynching, segregation, disfranchisement. And close ranks shoulder to shoulder with a... Now, Harrison goes after Du Bois in The Voice, right? And he writes a piece called The Descent of Dr. Du Bois. And basically what he says, well, you know, we can differ on the war. You know, I mean, it doesn't mean, you know, I agree with you or anything like that, your position, but you don't have to take it there. You don't have to go to that place, right? And he tears up Du Bois, and he ties it into the fact that Du Bois puts in an application for a captaincy. Du Bois doesn't get the captaincy, but he had put it in. And that had been a secret, you know, I mean, people didn't really know, right? And so Harrison puts it out. Du Bois will never speak about him again. You talk about reasons why Harrison's not known. Well, that may be one additional reason, right? And Du Bois is very much discredited by the younger generation of militants, the Harrison, the Randolph, the Owen, the Richard B. Moore, the Marcus Garvey. And it, as I said, Du Bois writes multiple autobiographies. He doesn't really want to talk about it. You know, I mean, it's it, you know, I'm, as I said earlier, you write biographies. It's important to tell all, warts and all, and nobody's perfect, right? But this is one of the points in Du Bois's life, one of the things he is least proud of, most embarrassed about, I think. But I go into this, and I let others speak, you know, on the topic, right? So as we end 1918, right on time for questions, we see Hubert Harrison. What Harrison, they finished the Liberty Congress, and Harrison now has bold plans to take his militant, race-conscious, radical message down south. He's got a lot of heart, right? He's going to take it down south to the heart of where the black population is. So by 1918, by the summer, Harrison is Harlem's considered the center of radical black thought. Hubert Harrison is the leading voice of Harlem radicalism. Although he's only 35, he's recognized as a brilliant orator, writer, thinker, and activist. He had led in challenging capitalism and white supremacy, had been a leading black activist and theoretician in the Socialist Party, had founded the first organization and first paper of the new Negro Movement, was a major black protest leader in wartime message. His class and race-conscious message influenced a generation of activists and common people. He had laid out broad parameters that would shape and influence much black radical discourse, whether people knew it was coming from Harrison or not, for much of the 20th century. And as we're trying to show now, he left an important legacy for those of us today in the 21st century. So that's where we are for today. We're going to Q&A. That's okay? So Harrison, I mean, it's a lot of history we haven't learned before, correct? I mean, I think it's important because I think, again, as I said at the start of the session, a lot of the issues that he's dealing with 100 years ago are ones we have in their modern day forms today. Yes, be it war, be it the left, you know, be it the forms organizations might take, be it, you know, questions of roles on the theater and stage. Yes, I'm sorry.
Did people ever offer an explanation as to why he wanted to join the military intelligence?
I don't think he ever offered it, or did David Levering Lewis. David Levering Lewis, I think, mentions briefly. The question was, did Du Bois ever offer an explanation why he wanted to join military intelligence? But I think that the reason would likely be he had made a decision at a certain point to support the NAACP position, which was to support the war effort, you know, in that form. By the closed ranks editorial, you know, he made those political decisions. When there was the question of the integrated officers training camps, as I recall, I'm going from memory now, but Du Bois uttered a statement which was something along the lines of, you know, there was all this militant demand for integrated camps and stuff, and I think he went with Spingarn's decision for the segregated camps, right? And he, or his statement, if I recall correctly, and I don't mean to get these mixed up, was we face a condition, not a theory. You know, and I leave you to interpret that, but that was his explanation for why he made the decision he did. Ben, and then, yes?
Yeah, I wanted to know if you could elaborate on Spingarn's the results of him being in the in military intelligence or in the intelligence, and what effect that is there any result and effect that was
well, I mentioned two. I mentioned that the officers' training camps were segregated, and I mentioned the effort to undermine the Liberty Congress and steal the thunder from this principal demand. There was no NAACP push for federal anti-lynching legislation. That was one of the key issues that he was trying to protect from being raised to Congress and things like that. I mean, that's what military intelligence did do. They monitored the black and the radical communities. So what was being given to people, I would have to dig a little deep. Some people have written on that, yeah. Yes, I'm sorry.
I was just wondering where Harrison wrote, you know, his response on, you know, the two ideological components dealing with like race. Like, did he write under the Negro socialism?
That five-part series, I think if you look, and afterwards, I have some books here, we can take a look, but I think in the section in the Harrison Reader, I have section on class radicalism, race radicalism, you know, internationalism, you know, different themes. And in the one on class radicalism, I think is where we would find where Harrison writes about those two things that I'm talking about. I think most particularly they would be in the series in the, I can't say, probably in the New York Call, and I think there were five articles in that series, and I had three of them in the journal. But if we look in the biography, we can get exact pages and sites for this. So I'll do that with you afterwards if you want. Yes.
I spoke to my friend and former colleague from Montclair, who's a specialist in African American literature.
Yes.
3 degrees from Rutgers.
Yes.
In African American literature. She never heard of Hubert Harrison before I told her I was here.
Excellent. So you're doing a great job.
She said it blew totally
good.
Blew her mind.
Yeah. You know, I put in long days, and I every day I think of all these new things that could be done. For instance, it's August, you know, and people are going to be going back to school in September, and I've been thinking about writing these an open letter to people who teach U.S. history, black history, black. Are you including Hubert Harrison? I mean, they teach black history courses, new Negro, they don't mention Harrison. Criminal. Black literature, the first regular black book reviewer in Negro newspaperdom. I mean, extraordinary reviews, right? They teach about radicalism. They don't talk about. The only person, Hubert Harrison, as we said last week, is the only person of his era, and I believe in U.S. history, to play leading signal roles in the largest class radical movement and the largest race radical movement of his era. How does he get omitted from these books? The pioneer soapbox, how do people write books that diverge off and talk about Harlem radicalism and soapbox oratory and not mention Harrison once? I think they have to be held accountable, you know, some of these people. But that's what we, you know, that's why we get it out. We'll start getting it out, and the people will start speaking on it. I think that's what's going to happen. Or raising it, you know, however we raise it. Go back, you know, and you see your NAACP friends again. You might ask them about this Spingarn medal. You know, you know about this. And for you, for speaking to, you know, faculty friends, yeah, that's great. That's good.
But I think that something you said in the book is one of the reasons is that he pissed off a lot of people, and particularly the churches.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So when you see what Booker T did to him, you know, if you imagine that, so they're not going to publicize this guy because he's the antithesis of what they're about.
Well, for some, although I will say, you know, Harrison, he had that very strong, you saw, I put in there, a very strong criticism of the role of Christianity historically and all of that in the church, right? Broadly speaking, the church. But he also, as he got older, his last organization is the International Colored Unity League. But Harrison's last organization is more broadly unitary. When he has the founding meeting of the Liberty League, it's at Bethel. It's at a church. I mean, he had, you know, with progressive ministers, he had relationships and things like that. But he would, you know, he would speak what he believed was, you know, accurately, which is, I think, what we need, you know. And it wasn't mean-spirited. And if you read, and Rogers makes that point, Rogers, yes. Rogers and Richard B. Moore, who knew Harrison personally, give what I think are probably the best portraits of him, you know, as a person and his importance and things like that.
I was always under the impression growing up that, like, the NAACP was one of those organizations that was just started by white people, and it wasn't really, like, I mean, I don't know much about, like, him, but right. I did, because my dad's from Panama, I did grow up learning a bit about communism, and I know that the Communist Party actually did a lot more for Black Americans, at least at the start of the Civil Rights Movement, and that wasn't W.E.B. Du Bois the only, like, Black member for, like, the longest time.
Later, in later life, he joins the Communist Party, yeah.
So I was never under the impression, and at least, like, despite the name, I was never under the impression growing up that there was really an organization that was for Black people. I didn't think any really existed until, well, the later part of the Civil Rights Movement. Like, I mean, around, like, the, after World War II.
A couple of things on what you said. I'm going to get to you. What you said, when we did previously, when Harrison talks about the founding of the NAACP, it's after there's some pogroms, you know, in the Midwest, right? And they have some meetings in New York at a place called Charity's Ball. And it's primarily white activists and radicals, you know, who meet and found some Black activists. And there is a recounting of what goes on at that meeting. And that's when Harrison comments. When some of the Black activists spoke up and spoke their mind at that meeting, it was taken out of what got published, you know, in terms of the meeting. And Harrison says, this is no way for this organization to function, you know, with white people's expectation of how Black people should act. So that was one thing that's, you know, important in that early period. Now, regarding your father and the Panama and the Communist Party and things, what's important, I think, is Harrison later on, he tries to maintain, you know, he'll be critical, but he'll maintain relations with everybody. So he'll talk with the communists and the, you know, and all this. But when the Communist Party makes what some people consider its major progress in the period 1928 to 1930 on the Negro question,
they were the first people that put, like, or they would put front money for like Black people to move into, like, exclusively white neighborhoods. Yeah. And, like, the NAACP didn't support it. Or they would put front money for them to open up, like, businesses there and stuff like that. They didn't have many Black members, but they did stuff like that. And the NAACP didn't. Like, they weren't supportive of it.
But when the Communist Party makes its major change, because the Socialist Party, as we see, wasn't very good on this question, right? And the Communist Party started out wasn't very good, right? They make change in the 28 to 30 period, and there are three aspects of their theoretical approach. One is, they treat the Negro question as a revolutionary question, which is important, and which is what we see in Harrison way back, right? But so too bad they weren't drawing more from that. Two, the Communist Party starts articulating a position drawn mostly from Soviet nationality theory that there's a Negro nation in the U.S., right? There's people of mixed mind on that, right, historically. But the third aspect, which doesn't get all the attention it should, in my opinion, is the second part of the Communist Party position, which makes it the phrase they use, it's the duty of the white comrades along these lines to jump at the 100%, to jump at the throat of the 100% bandit white chauvinist or something like that. In other words, for European Americans to take, you know, really take up the fight against white supremacy. And that was one of the things that, you know, won them some respect, you know, for fighting the good fight. Now, but what's also interesting, and we'll start, and maybe we'll get into with Alan next week, we hope you can come, because Alan comes out of the Communist Party, right? But he leaves, and he goes independent in the 1960s, but he's familiar with that history of the period you're talking about, the 30s, 40s, 50s, and all of that. And he lived right here in Brooklyn. And so he talks about strengths and weaknesses, you know, in terms of some of the work they did, in a pretty even-handed way, I think. So it'll be, people might find it interesting, you know, but we're going to focus mostly on his historical work on the 17th century. Sorry.
Did Harrison deal anyway with the the origin, the real reasoning for World War One?
Well, in these things, I think he's arguing that it, you know, it's the imperialist search. And he, well, forgive me. And what he also gets into in more depth, I'm actually saving that for the period after 1918, because he writes much more on it, he talks about Africa and its central importance, and that's what so much of these European powers are fighting over. Mm-hmm. And he does that more pronounced, I think, than any of his generation. Writes piece after piece. Now, I was talking about the early period. He's talking generally, you know, but later on, within a year or two, as he comes and puts it all in perspective, he says that's what he was, you know, he'll talk about, he was arguing about, it was the third world, if you will, he doesn't use that phrase, right, that was being fought over, but particularly African questions, right, you know, and...
spread of colonialism.
Yeah.
Harrison ever, like, made a critique on, you know, like, the aftermath of the Russian Civil War, you know, what was going on in the Soviet Union?
Well, Harrison was basically sympathetic to the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia. He spoke early with he'd be on platforms with John Reed's wife, he spoke and he says some very positive things. But he's got this bitter experience with the white socialist, right? So he says, you know, we've got not such a big problem with the international communist movement or socialist movement, you know, and he even puts out a call for a colored international and stuff like that. But he goes, this has got to be dealt with back here. And as I said, as late as 1920, he's writing articles in the Negro World, holding up that position that the socialists took in 1912 and saying, have you changed from this position yet? And of course they hadn't. But now Harrison with the communists also, and you were mentioning about money and things like this, there's a couple things. One, when Harrison lives in poverty, right? After he loses that postal job, he's in poverty basically the remainder of his life. I mean, he makes a little decent living for a while when he's the managing editor, unofficially, of the Negro World. But and he'll make a little money when he's lecturing for the Board of Education. But it's always five kids, you know, he's at the edge all the time. And but in 1917, when he has the voice, he is reportedly offered $10,000, which is big money, by a white supporter back then, and he says no. We're not, you know, because then you're going to want me to sing your song, you know, and I'm not going to do it. And regarding the communists, you were talking about they put money up for people to move. They reportedly offered Harrison, and this is from the FBI documents, I think it was in 1921, a large sum of money, I think $10,000 was the figure, to be, quote, I'm quoting, but it's not exact quote because I don't have it right in front of me, but the phrase was something along the lines of to be the party's stalking horse against Garvey. And he said, no, I'm not playing that, right? And it's important to look at whatever these organizations are, where they get their money from, right? Follow the money, right? Mm-hmm. So, for instance, Randolph and Owen, the Messenger magazine, that was their paper, you know, it got wide circulation. And I went to, there's a thing up here at New York Public Library on 42nd Street. There's the papers of something called the Garland Fund. It was some guy was wealthy and he started giving money to progressive and black causes and things like that, you know. And he'd give it to the NAACP, you know, and various other groups. But he would give to the Messenger. And in those papers are the mailing lists for the Messenger, so you get an idea of who their supporters are, right? And you can more or less tell by a lot of the names, you know, they might not, you know, it's probably not a largely black, you know, audience. You see that. So you see that there with the money. I mentioned about the money being outright offered with the NAACP and Du Bois's close relationship with Spingarn. Maybe if Du Bois was stuck or something like that, you know, Spingarn was of some means, you know, he would help him. Du Bois writes, you know, financially at times and things like that. Harrison turns down those monies. Garvey addresses these issues, and this will be gotten into in some detail in Volume 2, by a lot of his financial operations, right, which some are very, you know, the Liberian construction loan, the Black Star Line.
I just want to say one thing, because I'm Jamaican, and most Jamaicans I know have a very high opinion of Garvey. I mean, he's a national hero, and not just that, but he's, let me just finish.
Go ahead,
as a matter of fact, go ahead. Because you said a lot of people.
I generalized too much, but this was at UT in Toronto. where we were like, we actually did a thing in Jamaican Student Union where they did a discussion of Garvey. We watched the biography and people talked about it. So maybe I'm speaking from a particular subset, mm-hmm. because well, a lot of them, they grew up in Canada, but they also spent some time in Jamaica, so I don't know what you would consider them.
Oh, I see. I consider them Jamaican Canadians, but...
Right, so I should say Jamaican Canadians.
Very often, but the grassroots Jamaicans in general have a very high opinion, the Rastafarians, the different groups. He's a national hero. You know, you're not going to please everybody.
Yeah, no, I think what you're saying is very important, and I think that's accurate. And
yeah.
And that's why when I do Volume 2, I mean, what I try and do, as I say, I try and write the whole story. I try and write as accurately as I can, but you got to write tight, you know, and just limit to stay with what you can say, you
right.
know, and point to concretely to. So, but there will be, in Volume 2, I will have much, you know, to shed on some of these issues that people, you know, will... Other people, I think, will be able to do a lot more with, you know, in various ways, you know. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Are any of Harrison's children still around?
Yeah. I showed a picture in the first week. He's got, not his children. His children all passed, although I knew two of them, right, in New York. The daughter who was, she was living up in Yonkers, and the son on Bradhurst, right? And, on 150th, I guess. And the grandchildren. There's a daughter up on in Harlem and a son on the West Coast. Great-grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren here in Brooklyn area. And they come to some of the events, you know, and sometimes I'll speak with, particularly the grandson is very good, you know, going around. And they're very much down. And I mentioned, and I got one more call I got to make, but we're on the verge of finalizing the payments for a grave site marker for Harris. And he's buried up in Woodlawn Cemetery in the Bronx. Which has got a history, you know, of some important people being buried up there. And they're very eager to get the commemorative marker for Harrison because they want to, you know, include him in their, you know, outward reach to people. And we've got people who I believe will want to start, you know, setting up some type of commemorative event. Another commemorative event, which we're not going to, which has to get picked up again, is 134th Street in Lenox, which is where Harrison would often lecture, but he lectured all over Harlem, all over the city. Used to be called Liberty Corner. His organization was the Liberty League that speaking about liberty and stuff like that. And it was voted unanimously at Community Board 10 after we got a petition signed to rename it Hubert Harrison Way. Then they imposed a moratorium. And what's bothered me now is, I don't know if you followed just last week, they've just recently, James Baldwin, right?
Yes.
Somehow that one got through, you know, and they named the street, which is good. I mean, I'm glad they named, you know, a street after James Baldwin, but it raises anew the question of what happened to the moratorium in terms of Hubert Harrison. But we have to go today. So thank you all for coming. Next week, we're going to do Theodore W. Allen.